In this video, we'll go over the comparable company's valuation, from learning the basic theory to applying the concepts on Excel and eventually reaching a valuation range for a company. And even though the name sounds very fancy, this is actually a valuation method that we use all the time, as it's simply valuing an asset by comparing it to other similar assets. Suppose we found a house that we like that costs $300,000 and it's got 2,000 square feet. But because this is our first house, we're not really sure if it's worth the price, and so we look around the neighborhood to see if there's other houses that have been sold recently. In the process, we find out the house in front was sold for $600,000, but it's bigger at 4,000 square feet. So it's not quite fair to compare the price difference, as there's obviously a difference in size as well. Instead, we can use a ratio like the price per square foot, and this way we can find out that they're both actually selling for $150 per square foot. Based on this metric, it seems like the house that we want is actually selling at a fair price. That's the basic idea with this valuation method. Now that we have an understanding of this, let's take a look at the key steps in a comparable company's valuation, also known as a multiples valuation. Firstly, you need to identify comparable companies. The theory is that similar companies provide a good reference point to value the company that you're targeting. And I say companies here, but this is really for any asset. It could be back to our housing example, where you looked at neighboring houses to be able to tell what your house is worth as well. Secondly, we need to find the relevant numbers, which will allow us to calculate the multiples or the ratios. For the housing example, it was gathering the price as well as the size to then be able to calculate the multiple, which was the price per square foot. Once we gather all the data, we can benchmark these multiples, so calculating the averages, the medians, etc. of all of the comparable companies. And lastly, we can determine the valuation range for the company that we're interested in. And don't worry if this wasn't all that clear, we'll get into all of these steps in detail, so let's get into it. Step 1 is selecting the comparable companies, and this step is quite important. If you don't select the right companies, then your whole valuation is going to be flawed. There's really two types of things you need to consider here: business and financial. When it comes to business, it's making sure they're in the same industry, that they operate in similar market regions, and they have a similar target customer. After all, it wouldn't be fair to compare a luxury fashion brand like, say, Dolce & Gabbana to a fast fashion brand like H&M, even though they're both selling clothes, right? On the financial side, it's about their numbers. Are they of similar sizes? It wouldn't be all that accurate to compare a startup with $1,000 in revenue to a company that's mature and has $10 billion in revenue. There's also profitability, so seeing if they have similar margins, and the credit profile, which is essentially how risky they're perceived to be by investors. With these points in mind, how do we go about actually finding comparable companies? A simple and free way to go about it is looking at the company you're interested in and looking at their annual report. Suppose we're looking to value Nike, just going to Nike's annual report, there's a section called competitors, in which you can see it's stating all of the competitors that they have and what they do. Alternatively, 4-pay options include Bloomberg or Capital IQ. Depending on where you work or study, these might be available to you for free though. In my case, for example, when I studied at Cornell, these were available to us students. This whole process should end up with you finding about 5 to 10 comparable companies. The next step is gathering the relevant data and calculating the multiples. For this, we first need to know what multiples we'll be using, and generally these are split into enterprise value multiples or equity value multiples. The enterprise value ones here are in dark blue, while the equity value ones are in the lighter blue. The difference is that enterprise value refers to the entire business, so both debt and equity holders, while equity value is only referring to the equity holders. When looking at the multiples, EBITDA and revenue both flow to debt and equity holders, while earnings is only for equity holders, as it's net of interest expense. Unfortunately, these multiples aren't always applicable. For example, if a company has no earnings or very little earnings, you probably can't use a price-to-earnings ratio. Similarly, you might not even be able to have EBITDA in there. And so in that kind of a scenario, probably your EV over revenue is going to be your best resource. These are some of the more popular ratios, but there's also some industry-specific ones, like EV over subscribers for a media company like Netflix, or EV over square footage for a real estate firm. Once we know the metrics that we want, we can go ahead and start gathering the data that can either be done in a company's annual report, in Bloomberg, in CapIQ, etc. To apply this theory, let's suppose that we're a lemonade business called Enjoy Lemon over here, and we're trying to assess our value, so how much we're worth. And for that, we've gathered these comparable companies, which are some of our competitors, and we've got their different sets of data that we're gonna need to then be able to calculate the three different multiples that we've got over here. To calculate these multiples, we're gonna need both the enterprise value as well as the equity value. So let's go ahead and find out how to calculate them. For the equity value, it's just gonna be the share price times the shares outstanding, press enter there, And from there, you can just drag it down by just going Control C. Then we'll go Alt H V F. That's just gonna paste the formulas for us. Press the F2 key if you wanna verify that. Then for the enterprise value, that's gonna be the equity value plus the net debt, which is just debt minus cash. So we'll go equals equity value plus the net debt over here. And again, just drag that down, Alt H V F. Nice, now we can go ahead and start calculating these as we have the relevant data. So for the EV over revenue, it's just gonna be the enterprise value. Let's make sure to lock that one so we can move it across. So press the F4 key three times there, such that the dollar sign is only on the H. Then we're gonna divide that by the revenue over here and press enter. Then we can just drag that across. So we'll just select it and then we'll go to Alt H V F. And there you go. So we have it both for the revenue as well as for the EBITDA. For the PE, this is going to be slightly different as this is the equity value and not the enterprise value. So for this one, it's gonna be equals to the equity value divided by the net income, which is essentially the same thing as the price per share over the earnings per share. Press enter. Then we're just gonna drag that down, then Alt H V F. Nice, that's the end of the second step. And speaking of valuation, if you're liking this video, you can also check out our complete finance and valuation course, where an investment banker, a financial analyst, and myself teach everything we know about finance, valuation, and financial modeling. First, we start with the basics of financial accounting and ratio analysis, where we learn to analyze a company's financial health using Apple's real annual report as an example. Once we're comfortable with the content, we start with financial modeling through a three-statement model. Then we begin the valuation phase with the discounted cash flow method, starting with the theory of the time value of money, all the way to calculating the weighted average cost of capital. After the theory, we'll apply our learnings by creating a full discounted cash flow on Adobe, looking at their real financial statements to eventually derive a valuation range and an implied share price. Alongside the discounted cash flow, we'll learn two more common valuation methods, the comparables companies valuation, as well as the present transactions valuation. Once we have all the valuation ranges, we'll create visuals to showcase our findings and learn how we can present our investment thesis in a stock pitch format. So if you're interested, we'll be running big discounts for the first week since this video is published, so go ahead and check that out in the link in the description. All right, back to the video. Now the third step is to benchmark the multiples. Because each lemonade company is gonna be slightly different, we wanna try to find something like an average or a median to be able to assess how much our company should be worth based on what multiple. So let's go ahead and do that. We're gonna get the highs, the quartiles, the average and the medians, all the way to the minimums. So for the high, that's just gonna be the max function. Press the tab key. Let's go ahead and select these, press enter. 75th percentile, for that we can use the quartile function. Press the tab key, the array is gonna be this one, comma. And over here, we want to find the third quartile, which is the 75th percentile. So put a 3 there, press enter. The average is just the average function. Then we'll select these. Then the median is just the median function there. Press enter. For the 25th percentile, it's also equals to the quartile function. And from there, we'll select this range over here. Press the comma key. And we want to find the 25th. So put a 1 there, press enter. And lastly, for the low, it's just the minimum. Press the tab key. And we'll select this range over here. From there, we can just go ahead and select this and drag it across. As you can see here, both the average as well as the median are the ones in bold because they're usually the most relevant ones. Typically, you might want to prefer using the median if there's a lot of outliers, which the average accounts for. So for example, let's say that this Lemon Co. over here had say 100 times EV over revenue. Then as you can see, the average would be distorted, but the median would actually stay the same. So that's why sometimes you might prefer to use the median. Let's now work on the final step, which is determining a valuation range. And for this, we'll be down over here where we want to find out the Enjoy Lemon valuation, starting off with the implied enterprise value. For the EV over revenue, that's just gonna be equals to, we can select either the average or the median over here. Let's say we go for the median, then we multiply that by the revenue, which is gonna be this figure over here for Enjoy Lemon. Press enter. Once we have the implied enterprise value, we already have the net debt, which is gonna be this figure up over here. Then make sure to lock it, press the F4 key once and press enter. So the implied market value is just gonna be equals to the implied enterprise value minus any debt that they have, and then press enter. Lastly there, for the shares outstanding, that's gonna be equals to the shares outstanding that they got over here, so that's 125. And then the implied value per share is just gonna be equals to the implied market value divided by the shares outstanding. So that gives us 9.61. From there, we can go ahead and drag this over. So we'll go ahead and select it. I'll just drag it over here. If we've locked everything correctly, which I think we haven't because we forgot to lock the shares outstanding, press the F4 key there, then just copy and paste that. Now we've got for the EV over EBITDA, we've got a share price or an implied share price of 13.05. Then lastly here, we've got the PE ratio, which is going to be slightly different because this is an equity multiple and not a enterprise value one. So it's actually going to get us the implied market value. For that, we'll go to equals, we'll select the median and then multiply that by the net income over here for Enjoy Lemon, press enter. We can get the shares outstanding, just copying it from across, and that should give us the share price, which is going to be 9.77. If you want to go ahead and also want the implied enterprise value, you can go reverse that calculation. So we will actually copy the net debt that we've got equals this one plus the market value. That should give us the enterprise value as well. So here we could conclude with something like, hey, the implied value per share for Enjoy Lemon is around, say, $9 to $13, which seems to be in line with the current share price of 11.4. One thing to note is that the comparable companies valuation is not a perfect method. On the pro side, it is very simple to use and it doesn't take too much time. Definitely a lot easier than something like a discounted cash flow. That being said, on the con side, it's easily influenced by the market, which can also be a pro sometimes. So for instance, say if the entire market is overvalued, then obviously your company is going to be overvalued as well because it's based on industry peers. Another con, especially for big companies, is that it's not very easy to find comparables. For example, if for a company of the size of Apple with all of their offerings, it's not that simple to find another competing company there. For these reasons, it's quite common to use more than one method to value a company. For example, similar to the comparable companies is precedent transactions, which is also market-based, but on how much was paid for a similar transaction in the past. Then there's discounted cash flow, also known as DCF, which looks internally at the company's future cash flows to estimate value. Now, in order to keep this video concise, we actually had to make a few simplifications, so let's look over them. For the shares data, which we found on the Excel file as the shares outstanding over here, usually it's not all that simple to find this. There's other types of shares that we need to account for, like stock options, convertible bonds, and other things like that that are going to change the number of shares outstanding. Then there's calendarization, and not all companies finish the fiscal year at the same time. In our case, we didn't really consider the dates, but generally speaking, maybe a company finishes their fiscal year, say, in May, while another one finishes it in September. And so there's going to be a discrepancy in the time period that you're comparing, which you'll need to adjust for. Lastly, going from enterprise value to equity value usually has a few more line items than just net debt. These sometimes include preferred stock, minority interest, etc. Now, those are not all the simplifications, there's other ones, but we don't want to make this video too long. Let me know down in the comments if you want a video on comparable companies for a real company. For more on valuation, you can check out this link over here for our course, this other video over here for the discounted cash flow method, or this video over here to look at valuation methods more generally. That's all for this video. Hit that like, hit that subscribe if you liked it, and I'll catch you in the next one.